Good morning. Please be seated. I'm Joseph James, the pastor here at Trinity. We're glad to have you all here with us this Lord's Day. And I want to share with you a few announcements, if I might. First, I invite you to please sign the pew registration pad so that we can make sure that we have all the updated information for you. And if we need to contact you for something that may come up in the life of the church, it would be a great way for us to do that if we have all your current information. Also want to share with you a few announcements. Mainly it's about scheduling, about things that are coming up in the life of the church. As you know, as we conclude Advent over the next couple of weeks and then rush into the Christmas season, we want to remind you of everything that's going on. Tonight is the last night of the Living Christmas Story. We had a great crowd of people within our Bethlehem village, and we had nearly 600 people come through in the cars. We were steady for 2 hours. So if you haven't come to come through Bethlehem, come on. If you can participate tonight, it's not too late. There's still sign up, or just show up. We'll put you to work. We start eating about 5 and get out there about 5:50. So we're ready for when people come. So that's tonight. Also, you may have had the signs, the yard signs, either the yard signs for the Living Christmas Story or the prayer signs that we did earlier in the year. Yeah, I hope you still have your prayer signs. I hope you still keep those in your yard as well. But either one of them, we want to recycle them. So especially the metal stakes that go into the ground, that would be a great help. So we want to keep those back. So if you could return those so that we could use those for years to come. Next Sunday, during this 8:45 service, it's going to be Christmas carols, all Christmas carols. It's going to be a time of lessons and carols, reading some scriptures, but also these Christmas carols for this time of year. That will be our last service of the year, 8:45 service. So on the 24th and the 31st, we'll only have one service both of those days. So just to keep you in mind of that. Now, at the 11 o'clock next week, we have the Children's Christmas Program. And at 5 o'clock, the Classic Christmas, followed by Lessons and Carols. I will tell you that for Sunday school next week, our gift to the teachers is that we will be in the chapel during Sunday school from about 10 to 10:30, singing Christmas carols there as well. So if you've got a Sunday school class and it's kind of hard to find a teacher this time of year, come on in the chapel. We'll be glad to have you. So that's next week. It's a full week. 24th is Christmas. Yes, right. We'll be doing the Christmas carols in the chapel on the 24th. Thank you. On the 24th, the 11 o'clock service is still Advent 4. This is the latest Advent can be in ever, okay? So you got Christmas, you got Advent in the morning, and in the evening you got Christmas Eve. So at we'll have the Christmas carols at 10. 11 o'clock we'll have our worship service, and at 5 is when we have our Christmas Eve service. Now at 4:30, I think, is when we're starting our pre-service music. So there will be duos, trios, singing, instrumentals, all of that starting at about 4:30. I think there are a few people that come to that 5 o'clock service. So you might want to come a little early and get a seat. So you'll be hearing the service music as you come in. But if you can't make the service, we are going to be on the radio that day, just that for that 5 o'clock service. So please let people know as we are part of all that is going on here in Sumter with the gift of the Living Christmas Story and, of course, our Christmas Eve services. We'll hear a lot more about that in the coming days. Friends, we are glad that you are here with us today. We invite you to stand and greet one another in the name of the Lord. Thank you. Friends, will you pray with me? Lord, the warmth in our hearts is matched by the warmth we see in the smile of a neighbor. Bless us in this time of worship. We ask these things in your name. Amen. Now we invite our children to come forward for our children's moments with Angela.
Good morning. How is everybody? Good. So I wanted to talk with you this morning about house cleaning. Does that make sense? Well, let me explain. So my mother is a really good house cleaner. She likes for everything in her house to be just right. When I was growing up, everything was just right. Everything had its place. And hardly ever was there any kind of dust or dirt around, because she couldn't stand whenever she would walk on the floor, and if there was the slightest bit of dirt, it had to be cleaned up. So she did a great job of keeping the house clean and everything in its place. And I really appreciated that. Didn't realize it till I got older. But it was really nice. And then that was on a daily basis. Can you imagine what it was like when we had... Yours is too? Uh-huh. I bet there are a couple of folks that are like that, huh? But can you imagine what it was like when we knew we were going to have company? So do you think that she said, oh, it's all clean, we don't have to worry about it? Or do you think that she immediately started cleaning even more and putting things away and handing me a vacuum and my sister a dust cloth? Do you think that might have been what happened? Then you're exactly right. When we knew we were having company, we went into super cleaning mode to make sure that our house was just right for anybody who might come. And since Mom kept it clean a lot of the other times, it was clean when we didn't know we were going to have company, which was great. So do you get prepared when people are coming over? What kind of things do you do to get prepared? That's right. Cleaning those rooms and putting your shoes away. That's right. Well, can you imagine what it would be like? That's when Grandma and Grandpa come. Can you imagine what it would be like if a king were coming to your house? What? I know. A king. It would be great if the king came in and said, "It's great." Well, this morning, when we read our scripture, whenever Pastor Joseph reads the scripture and gets ready to share the word, he's going to be reading from the book of Mark, the Gospel of Mark, and it talks about how people knew that a king was coming. And it goes all the way back, and it quotes the Old Testament and says that there's going to be a king, but there's going to be somebody that comes before the king to prepare the way. And that person was John the Baptizer. And he came and he didn't tell people, "You need to clean your house because a king is coming." He said, "We need to make sure that our hearts are clean and that we are ready for the King of Kings." And who would that King of Kings be?
Jesus.
Jesus, that's right. So John came to share that we needed to get ready. He was letting us know that the king was coming. He was letting those people know. And you know what? This is the season when we celebrate the King of Kings and Jesus, the Prince of Peace, coming into the world. And we've lit the candle of peace today. So we've got the candle of hope and the candle of peace. And it's not our houses we need to get ready. It's our hearts. Because Jesus came as a baby, but guess what? Jesus is coming again. And it's not about having our houses ready. It's about having our hearts ready. Okay, so let's pray and let's give God thanks, but ask God for help and guidance. Dear God, thank you for sending the King of Kings, the Prince of Peace, the Savior of the world. Help us to prepare our hearts for his return. We love you. Amen.
Our scripture lesson for this morning is from the Gospel of Mark, beginning at the first chapter, and we'll be reading the first 8 verses. I invite you to stand as you're able for the reading of the Gospel. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in the prophet Isaiah, "See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way. The voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight.' John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, 'The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I'm not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit.'" May God bless the reading, the hearing, and the understanding of this, the holy word of our Lord. Please be seated. May we pray. Prepare the way of the Lord. Prepare the way of the Lord. And all people shall see the salvation of our God. Open our hearts that the way may be prepared. In Jesus' name, amen. If you haven't been to the Living Christmas Story, you should go tonight. The sets, the costumes, the streets of Bethlehem are alive. It's a wonderful time. The production of that we do here at Trinity for this Christmas season, it brings the birth narratives of Matthew and Luke to life. Most of what we do comes from Matthew and Luke. It is a celebration of Emmanuel, God with us. Matthew and Luke are the ones that show the inbreaking of God's grace to humanity in the little tiny village of Bethlehem. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. We celebrate that birth at Bethlehem. That birth that was for the whole world, all of humanity. That's what Matthew and Luke do. They remind us that this birth, this inbreaking of grace was for all humanity. Now, that's Matthew and Luke. John, on the other hand, the Gospel of John starts in a more cosmic, universal way. It shows the significance of Christ in a theological and philosophical way. You know the beginning of the Gospel of John. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. Whereas Matthew and Luke are just about us as human beings, the Gospel of John, it's about all creation. From one side of the universe to the other, there is this hope of all creation with John. The hope of humanity with Matthew and Luke. The inbreaking of God comes on these larger scales. But what about Mark? What do we do with Mark? If we base the living Christmas story on the Gospel of Mark here at Trinity, we could save a lot on time and resources. Because in the Gospel of Mark, there are no swaddling clothes, no shepherds, no wise men, no Joseph, no Bethlehem, no star. There's no nativity at all. No Christmas story in Mark at all. It even starts in a jolted way. The first verse, the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, no verb in that whole sentence. It just comes at us, almost like an invasion, an incursion into the world. It breaks into nothing, from nothing into this, and the way that it opens. You get this grumpy guy. The NRSV calls him John the Baptizer. You and I grew up calling him John the Baptist. Not denominational. He was more of a baptizer than he was a Baptist, but that's neither here nor there. But you get this grumpy guy named John with a beard. And the only thing I can picture is his beard matted with dried honey and locust legs. With this, you know, we got those nice, easy costumes over there in the fellowship hall for the living Christmas story. John's got on coarse camel hair and a leather belt. And he comes and he's shouting at people like a street preacher. He's on the edge of the wilderness outside of Jerusalem, and people are flocking to him to see what the show is about. And he's baptizing people in what we call the Jordan River, but it's more like a glorified ditch, as wide as it is in places. He's telling people about the forgiveness of sin and repentance. And he's pointing the way to one who comes later, Jesus the Christ. Not in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. But John introduces us to the adult Jesus. You see, Mark's beginning is the middle of the story of Jesus that you would find in Matthew, Luke, and John. Mark starts in the middle. John the Baptist's words are not on a cosmic scale as in John, the Gospel of John. They're not on the human scale with Matthew and Luke. But they're on a very personal one. Mark gets in our face. Mark is not about up there or up there. Mark, and his contribution to Christmas, is down here with us. Mark's message of the gospel doesn't begin in Bethlehem. It starts with you and with me. About the way we live. We have this Christmas present of the Nativity. But the Gospel of Mark is how will we live with that gift? For unto you is born this day. Repent and believe in the Gospel. We are given the gift, an opportunity to make the way of the Lord straight in our hearts and in our lives. You see, my friends, the inbreaking of God didn't just happen on a cosmic scale. It didn't just happen in Bethlehem 2,000 years ago. God's grace is breaking in your life today. Christmas isn't just about 2,000 years ago. And it's not just about a date on a calendar. It's about how we receive the gift of forgiveness and grace, about how we prepare the way of the Lord. Not just when we stand outside in the parking lot around pots of fire, dressed up, but how we live as teachers, office workers, and students. How we live in offices and on the streets. You see, Mark's gospel is nitty-gritty, and it's here and now. In our lives, here and now, we live. We live for Christ. We receive that gift by how we love and how we work, how we speak, and how we act. And like the bearded John with the honey in his beard, we point the way to one who is greater than us. We point the way to a world that is in the dark. The Gospel of John is right in that there is a light that came into the world, but you and I need to be carriers of the light. Not just the light of the tree, or the light of the Advent wreath, or the light of the table, but the light of Christ. If you ever attended the 11 o'clock service, you know that at the end of the service, Crucifer is here and the lights are behind, the torchbearers. acolytes. And they carry the light up the aisle into the world. And you and I follow. We follow the light into the world. Mark's gospel is a Christmas present for the rest of the year. It is the story of the inbreaking of the gospel in our lives. Mark's beginning is for the rest of the year, for the rest of our lives. Because Emmanuel, God with us, is in the here and the now, and from the now on. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. As a response to the Word of God, let us proclaim our affirmation of faith, the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the Maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day He rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence He shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. We gather this day mindful of all that God has given, the many blessings that Christ offers us in life and health and joy and peace. We're also mindful of those around us in this world who do not have life or joy or health or peace and abundance. Some in our own neighborhoods, our own town, some on our own pew. As we gather this day, let us be mindful of those beyond ourselves, for whom the gift of Christmas means more than just tinsel and turkey. Let us remember and claim the grace of God in all of our lives and in the ways we are called to share it. Friends, as we gather this day, I invite you to lift the prayer concerns and joys of your hearts before the Lord with just a name, just a phrase. And as we hear those names and phrases, let us as a congregation respond in power and in grace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Let us pray. Lord, we are thankful for the ways you have called this church to serve, for the blessings that have come about because of the living Christmas story, for the sense of purpose and hope and vision that it has cast for us, and what we can do and be within the life of this church over the past few months. We're thankful for the camaraderie and the friendship of the night. We're thankful especially, O Lord, for those whom this message is reaching. Hear our prayers this night as we as a church enter this season of celebration. Help us to be mindful of those around us and beyond us. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers.
Melissa.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers.
Jason.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers.
Anthony.
Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. In the silence of this place, in the depth of our hearts, we turn to your light and to your peace. And we pray now, O Lord, as your Son taught, when we pray together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us of our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. And now, will our ushers please come forward for the dedication of our tithe and offering. Let us pray. Thank you, O Lord, for these gifts and for the giftedness of this congregation. We thank you for empowering us to share what we have to further your kingdom in this place and around the world. Bless us, O Lord, as we seek to be your people. In Jesus' name, amen. Prepare the way of the Lord. Prepare the way of the Lord. Make his path straight in your heart and in your lives. Prepare the way of the Lord and go in peace. Amen.